Bossman Show here with Coach Michael Fly of the Florida Gulf Coast Eagles out of the Atlantic Sun Conference. Coach, what's good out of Fort Myers, man?
Always good down here, brother. About 75 degrees right now and sunny, and anytime it's not like that, we're confused down here, so it's hard to have a bad day in Fort Myers, in South Florida.
I'm confused, too, Coach. It's 44 degrees today, Coach. I'm confused right now. In the left, 44. Like, what's going on? But yes, indeed. Well, Coach, I must ask you, man, we talked when you first got hired in 2018, full-time as the head coach. I've been an assistant for a long time at Florida Gulf Coast. So tell me, Coach, what's been the biggest improvements in the program since you took over it, as you're the head man now going forward?
Well, I don't know if I'd even say improvements. We've had a lot of challenges, to be honest with you, and we're in a little bit of a situation that we haven't been in since I first got here. You know, when I got the job, I was really fortunate to be named the head coach here, and we were coming off a Atlantic Sun Championship for, I think, our third year at that point. You know, we had Brandon Goodwin go to the Atlanta Hawks now and is playing well for those guys, but lost him to graduation. Lost Zach Johnson, who was probably going to be preseason player of the year, to a grad transfer. Lost all of our other starters as well to graduation. So it was a little bit of a rebuild, you know, when I got the job. So what we've kind of done is we relied on some transfers last year that had been here before. Some guys played well, some guys did not. So we've kind of hit reset and recruited a pretty good mix of high school kids that are learning and growing, some junior college kids to try to keep us as mature as possible. But this is really the first time for years and years we were able to kind of reload a little bit. And just based on, you know, kind of numbers from a graduation standpoint, the last 2 years it's been, hey, we got to rebuild this thing into what we think it can be. So it's been an interesting challenge, but I was really proud of our guys. Even losing all five starters from a championship team and multiple pros, we were able to finish third in the league last year, had the best home record in the league. So I think we're moving in the right direction, but still got a lot of work to do.
And, Coach, like you said, what basically is a very key point for you now with the rebuild here and retooling is the development piece on and off the court, getting guys stronger in the weight room so they won't get injured. Also, going to be stronger to be able to take contact on the court and to play hard for you every night. And their skills, because when you have a mix of young and old guys and transfer guys, you have to get the guys all on the same page. So those 4 hours in the summertime is very key. And also, preseason working out there in September and October there, for November kicks off, it's very key to getting you guys on oiled up to get ready to play good now in January, February, and into March here.
For sure. You know, I'm so blessed. The staff that I've got around me is tremendous, and I'll just touch on the guys that do the things you mentioned. You know, I've got Travis Wallace as my strength conditioning coach, who was at UCF, was at VCU. You know, he's been at a really good level in college. He was actually an all-league player here in the Atlantic Sun at North Florida, and then was with the Toronto Raptors before he came with me. He was actually Kyle Lowry's personal strength conditioning coach. And so he kept Kyle, you know, in really good form. That had been something that had been an issue for Kyle, you know, when he was younger, was staying in shape. So Travis and he worked together, and I was fortunate enough. I was lucky, really, that Travis wanted to come back to college. So we've got legitimately an NBA strength conditioning coach, I think one of the best in the country, you know, at the mid to low major level. And then I brought Joey Cantenz on my staff, who was with me at Florida State. He was at USC with Coach Enfield. He was with us here. We made the Sweet 16 run, and he actually went over and spent 2 years in Germany in the top league there and worked with the San Antonio Spurs in the summer league. So, you know, those two guys handle — Travis does all my strength conditioning, and Coach Cantenz is player development. So we do things a little differently. We don't do much player development during practice. We'll practice as a team. Those guys do all individual workouts with Coach Cantenz in the mornings. But that way you're getting better as an individual, and it's not just, hey, we're going to spend 10 minutes in practice like a lot of programs do. So I think I've got, at this you know, low to mid-major level, I think we've got two of the best in the country at just what you're talking about, strength conditioning and also developing guys and skills and making sure they're improving.
Because, Coach, at the low to mid-major level, you have to find guys that you have to project forward. So when they're juniors and seniors, they'll be what they'll grow into. A lot of people understand that, Coach. I mean, you understand it because we both played and know the game. But you have to project guys to a degree at the low to mid-major level to make sure you have a guy that can come to a four-star, three-star guy by the time they're a junior or a senior with the player development and the strength and conditioning piece as well.
That's right. And, you know, like I said, there's two ways to do it. We originally, when I was here with Coach Enfield, did it with, you know, basically high school guys that really developed, you know, and a transfer here and there. And then, you know, Coach was really successful here. And then with Coach Dooley, we went more the transfer route with kind of, you know, ready-made guys that you sit out and then you hope you can incorporate them into your program. So, you know, I think we'll do a little bit of a mix of both, but you're 100% right. If you look at the two teams that have won our league since we've been to the NCAA tournament, we went in 2017, Lipscomb went in 18, and Liberty went in 19. They did it with all 3 and 4 year guys that had grown up through the program, you know, versus going the transfer route like we had done here the last few years. So, you know, we're kind of in the middle of that right now. I think we've got some really good young players. I think we got some good junior college guys. But realistically, when we step on the court right now, I've got 3 players that have played Division I basketball before.
Wow, yeah, that's definitely an interesting thing right there, Coach. And, like, for you guys, like, say, Florida's a very good recruiting ground. You got 4 schools in the A-Sun right there in Florida, which is yourself, Stetson, North Florida, and Jacksonville right there. So, trying to compete for the same kind of player, so how do you differentiate yourself, Coach, in your program? You kind of laid it out there. How do you go about it trying to, you know, to be the Coach Jackson, Coach Driscoll, Coach Jones, those guys, trying to get those guys that they want as well down in Florida?
Yeah, you know, I think we all probably recruit a little different guys just based on skill and kind of, you know, what our programs are about. But we've been really fortunate. You know, when I first got here from Florida State, Coach Enfield and I had a lot of relationships within the state of Florida based on our time in Tallahassee. So that kind of gave us a little bit of a jump on the competition early. And then guys that we were not able to even get on the phone when we first took the job here, you know, 2 years later, you're in the Sweet 16, and now you're able to get guys on the phone that are getting high major recruitment, you know. So we've kind of run the gamut here, you know, being able to recruit certain kids in Florida based on the success that we've had. And, you know, after the 2013 run, we signed some guys from the state of Florida that probably in a normal year we have no chance to get. And, you know, those guys kind of led to the next one, to the next one, to the next one. So the state of Florida is really, really taking care of us. I've actually got 3 coming in next year from Orlando as well. So, you know, we've been fortunate in that, you know, the other schools, they get some good players in the state too, but based on our success and kind of my ties for now going on, let's see, I was 3 at Florida State and this is 9 here for so 12 years. Yeah, I really got to compliment the high school coaches, the AU coaches in the state of Florida that have really taken care of this program.
Now, Coach, a lot of people are saying this, I told them in the past, you are to play a rough non-con schedule. You got 3 wins. But people understand it's a lot of the goals in there. You have to play guaranteed games. You have to go on the road a lot. Can't get some people to come in and play you at your place when doing a non-con. So 3 wins is not what you want. But do you feel like your team really grew from adversity? Which you have 3 D1 guys that you haven't played D1 ball before, at least get 3 wins, get them a taste of it before they jump into the A-Sun play here as they are right now?
You know, we did, JR, but I honestly, you know, I've told people even here locally this, if I had it to do over, I probably would have scheduled a little differently. You know, we scheduled the past 2 seasons as if we had all those all-league guys returning every year like we had in the past. And that's kind of what our fans have become accustomed to, and the people here is playing a really, really hard schedule. But, you know, if you look around the country at some of the most successful mid-major programs, they don't play, you know, a crazy hard game every night. You know, what a lot of programs have done is they'll play, you know, 6 to 8 tough games, sometimes 4 to 6, and then they're going to play 4 to 6 that if they feel like if they play well that night, that's a win. Well, what we did was go out and schedule the guarantee games, which is part of it. We played 3 of those, and then we played all programs that were either coming off 20-win seasons, league championships, you know, and that's just kind of what we've done here. But it was tough for my guys because, you know, in reality, we're losing to programs that where we are as a program right now on paper, you probably should lose to. Now we were fortunate to beat FAU and we had a couple of built in with non-ones, but I do think it helped us grow. What was hard was keeping those guys' confidence up that, hey, listen, you're not the team that your record indicates, but you're playing against junior, senior on the scouting report right now. And we're rolling out there with, you know, at any point I look on the court, I got 3 freshmen, a sophomore and a JUCO guy, you know, so it's just where we're at as a program. But I do think it makes you tougher. It prepares you, but you do have to fight a little bit, keeping guys' confidence up when really, you're losing some games that when you make the schedule, you say, hey, we better play really well tonight or this one's going to be a hard one to get.
You got that right, Coach. I think, like you said, playing against those high majors and quality mid-majors will help them down the road, whether it be this year, whatever happens next year and on beyond, because the experience they get now, they're like, oh, we've done this before. It's not new to us anymore. It's not novel now. We've already been through this situation, so it's all good going forward.
That's right, and if you look even at some of the best teams we've had here, one of the reasons we were able to make the run in 13, now we played some very winnable games in other parts of the schedule, but as far as at the top of the schedule, my mind that doesn't float on me too bad here. It's been a few years. I believe we played VCU, Iowa State, St. John's, Miami, and Duke that year. So when we got into the NCAA tournament, you know, they had played just as good of teams and tougher venues, actually. So that's kind of the model we've always followed, but with a team that's one of the most inexperienced teams in the country, which is what I have right now, you also want to be smart to schedule a few wins in there, and that's something we probably need to do a little more in the future if we're going to be young.
And, Coach, well, you got 3 wins in conference play now. You've got 6 wins on the year now, 3-3 in conference play. You got NJIT coming up this weekend. So how are your team feeling now with the guy that got to A-Sun play now, getting 3 wins and have an opportunity to prepare really good for NJIT, a team that went to North Florida and beat those guys a week or so ago down there. So, you know, those guys are ready to play coming down south for sure.
That's right. They've done a really good job. Coach Kennedy's done a really good job up there. They've got the best scorer in the league in Zach Cooks, who's actually a Georgia kid. You know, so I think they've got really good talent. They've got another Georgia kid, actually, San Antonio Brinson, who's had a good run for them as well. But they actually are in a very similar situation to us. They played a tough non-conference schedule, did not play well in the non-conference, and now have been able to turn it around coming into the league and are similar to us. You know, they've won some that were really good wins for them, probably should have won a few that they haven't. But I think it'll be a really tough test for us. And I told our guys the other night, we had won 2 in a row. We're in a 5-point game with North Alabama, got a lead with 3 minutes to go. And those are games probably with a few more juniors and seniors you get done, you know, and that's what we worked on today, game-ending situations. And, hey, guys, do you see on the film, this is what we could have done differently. So we got a chance, we take care of business at home, to have won 3 of our last 4 and be headed in the right direction. But I think this week's really important preparing for those guys, and I think they're as good from a talent standpoint as anybody that we have in this league.
Well, Coach, you have 3 young men on your roster from the Atlanta area. Can you just talk about those young men, what they mean to your program?
For sure. You know, Georgia has always been really, really good to us in recruiting. If you look back, I mean, our first really big get from that area was Bernard Thompson, who was an all-league player here from Rockdale County, helped lead us to the Sweet 16 and multiple league championships. We had Jamel Jones from Green Forest, who transferred to us from Marquette, who was an all-league player here as well. As you go through the years, Reggie Reed from Harlem High School had a very good career when he was here. And then obviously the most, you know, kind of famous one from the state's been Brandon Goodwin, who now is with the Atlanta Hawks and was unbelievable for us here in his 2 years and even in his redshirt year. So that allowed us to recruit guys like Jalen Harper, who obviously has it in the bloodlines, you know, played at Pebble Brook, who's one of the better programs in the state there. And obviously Jared had a tremendous amount of success at Auburn. And then we were able to get Brian Thomas, who unfortunately for him, you know, he played at Kell High School and played for Game Elite, one of the bigger AU programs in the state, has had an injury-riddled career, but is a great kid. And if his body didn't betray him so much, we've always believed in his talent and ability. It's just been tough to get him on the court. And then we've got Tracy Hector from the Jonesboro area that we took as a transfer because he was eligible immediately after one of our kids went down for season ending surgery, and he's been really good for us. He's one of our best defenders, was really productive the other night against North Alabama. Not a huge stat stuffer, but a guy that does a ton of things that win games for you, taking charges, and you know, he's had multiple games of 7 assists and 1 turnover for a power forward. So Georgia's always been really good to us. The South, both Georgia and Florida, have really taken care of us, and we hope they continue to do so.
I hate to miss you guys, Coach, because you know you come to Atlanta on the 13th of February. But I'll be in Chicago for the All-Star weekend. Because Trey Young's probably going to the All-Star game, so I already pretty much told me to book my stuff for Chicago for that weekend. We also had like Cam Reddish and those guys being the rookie sophomore game. So I'm going to miss you guys when you come to Kennesaw State, but hopefully to see you at the Final Four for sure, Coach.
Sounds like a plan, and you know, going to Chicago for All-Star weekend is not such a bad deal.
You got there. It's a little bit cold. Too cold for me. That's all it is. It's cold weather. That's the only thing. That's my whole trouble things, Coach. It might be a little too cold for me, man. I don't got to put the big – Coach, I hate cold weather, man. So if it's in the 50s, I'm okay. If it's like in the 20s, I'm going to be like, oh, my God, why am I here?
Well, we got to get you down to see us in Fort Myers and get you out of that cold weather and get you in the sun a little bit.
Hey, I would love to, Coach. We got to get that set up, man, for sure. All right, Coach. Thank you as always, brother.
Appreciate you guys having me on. Have a great trip to Chicago and a good rest of the year.
Grab a hold of Big Breakfast flavor at Hardee's. Try two breakfast sliders for just $2.99. Get Applewood smoked bacon or freshly grilled sausage with fluffy eggs and golden melty cheese all on a toasty little bun. Good morning, start at Hardee's. Available now for a limited time at participating restaurants. Tax not included.
All right, folks, back in the Bossman Show here at Mitch Henderson, coach of the Princeton Tigers out of the Ivy League in New Jersey. Coach, how you doing today, Coach?
I'm doing great. Doing great. How are you?
Coach, I'm doing wonderful, man. Good to speak with you, Coach. I want to start off and ask you, Coach, you've been at Princeton since 2011 as the head coach. And in the business of coaching, it's just a lot of turnover. So what's been the key to your longevity so far, being at Princeton since 2011, all these years?
Well, I mean, it's really just a function of being at a really good place where they support you. And I feel very fortunate to be also at a place where you can get involved with some really fine young men and coach them. And, you know, we really put a lot of emphasis on guys getting better while they're here. And Princeton's a special place to work. You get an opportunity to coach guys that are interested in being a real student athlete. Not that, you know, not that anybody else isn't doing it, but, you know, it's really an emphasis on both being a student and an athlete equally as strong. So I feel very fortunate to be able to be here and be the coach.
Yes, indeed. Now, Coach, the difference in the Ivy League is I found out when doing my research here that you guys can't practice at all during the summer session at all. Like, you really don't have much time with the players beyond that. You get to go home for summertime for the most part. So you pretty much have to do it kind of on the fly here during this last part of the year here when they come back from summer. Kind of get your team ready for the year. So kind of expound on that a little bit, Coach. Explain to my listeners a little bit how the little differences between coaching in the Ivy League versus coaching in the MAC or the MEAC or the MAC or the Northeast Conference as well up there near you guys.
Right. Well, I look at it, it's a good point, and it's a fair one, but I look at it and sort of because we have to, and we try to look at it a little differently. You know, the summers are obviously a great opportunity to get better, and as you mentioned, almost every school has summer access where you're doing, not only are you having summer school on campus, but you're having workouts. But what I've found is that, number one, the guys like to go home. They like to be around their families for a little bit. Can't stay home the whole summer, but also we put a big emphasis on summer internship possibilities. You know, there's a terrific Princeton Abroad program here where, you know, one of my guys, Ryan Schwieger, who was just Ivy League Player of the Week, was in the Philippines through Princeton and doing a study internship there. And we're obviously our goal is to be, you know, at the top of the Division I, you know, in terms of basketball programs, but also we want to develop the whole kid. And part of that is getting exposure to some different industries, maybe academic pursuits in the summers. So what I found is that there's not that much slip in when we get them back in the fall. They're really excited to come back. They're eager to get to work. And we had a little bit of a rough start in our non-conference, but I don't think it had anything to do with the summer. It's more just sloppy play. I think that overall, when you look at it's just a 4-year period and you want to get the most out of those 4 years when you're in college as possible. I think we do a good job of that.
And also, Coach, the difference is for your league is a lot of people understand you all play back to backs on the weekends there. And my question is more so about prep and recovery time because, you know, I know in the NBA I'm around the Hawks a lot here in Atlanta with Atlanta Hawks, so I know about back-to-backs, but those are grown men, per se, that are developed in their bodies. But these are 18, 19, 20-year-olds, not 21-year-olds who are in school having to go on a back-to-back. So say you have a tough, rough game on that front of first leg of that, who do you play the next night trying to keep everybody fresh to come back with that, Coach? So I kind of want to talk to you about that as well.
It's a really good question, and, you know, it's I would say, as you mentioned, we play Friday, Saturday in the league, and
I would say the Saturday night game is a guts game, and I think that's probably true in the NBA, but you're dealing with 18 to 22-year-old kids, not grown men, as you said. And, you know, even what we know now is, you know, sleep plays such a big factor, obviously recovery being a big factor with young kids. So we put a big emphasis on guts, right? Like, you've got to be able – you got to push through fatigue. And, you know, the unfortunate thing is the team that you're playing against is – has the same exact schedule that you have. So they're also, you know, having had played 24 hours before. And, you know, you can't lose your mental focus on that night. And, you know, we've seen the trend in the NBA of resting guys on those back-to-back weekends. And obviously for us, our goal is to win the league. And in order to do that, you've got to get two games on those big weekends.
Yeah, and Coach, as far as the prep, do you all may maybe watch a film on that Saturday morning before the game? Or, because I doubt you're going to do a shoot around after a tough night on a Friday night, so you got to really trust the guys to really be participating in that film session as well, or the scouting report when you play that Saturday game as well.
Yeah, it's what we do, and, you know, that's what works best for us is, well, Monday, Tuesday, we prepare for the Saturday game, and then Wednesday, Thursday, we prepare for the Friday game. And, you know, the guys know that they're not playing, you know, the Monday, Tuesday, they know that that game's not till Saturday, but we try to give them a little base understanding. So, but Wednesday, you've sort of got their full attention, Thursday, and then obviously play the game Friday, and you act as if you're playing just one game. I think that's worked best for us. And then Saturday morning, you kind of just completely get rid of whatever happened on Friday night, and you treat it like one more game. And, you know, we've all these guys have played AAU basketball. They've played three games in a day. They've, you know, they've seen a lot of different kinds of situations in their summer travel. So they're used to playing a lot, but the focus is the most important thing. I think that's what you're getting at. And that's where really where we try to hit them on Friday morning, walk through base and out of bounds plays, and then review the tactics that we're going to have for that night.
I hear that, Coach. I think it's so interesting to me because, you know, seeing it from the NBA perspective, hearing the college game as well is very interesting to me and my listeners because I know we're not used to it down here, but it's just the way to hear it and hear you lay it out so eloquently like that, Coach. It's great to hear for sure.
Well, I appreciate being able to talk through it. It's, and for us, it's normal, but I know it's not normal everywhere else.
You got that right. Now, Coach, now, I think it's also good for your guys is like, I think was also another bigger point is that your strength and conditioning coach has to be really important. Make sure the guys are in shape and keeping them from not getting injured because that piece of the equation, playing those back-to-backs with practice throughout the week, keeping those guys fresh and healthy, that guy's really key to your program, keeping your guys upright for sure.
You're right. You're right on about that too. And our guy, we have a guy named JD, and he's terrific. We really start this process in the fall of, you know, getting guys ready to play these two games in a row on a weekend, you know, layering in the sort of stamina and the conditioning that they're going to need to be able to play, you know, two games over the course of a long weekend. And, you know, it's, and, you know, the load also is the week of the game. You know, you've got to make sure you're not overtraining your players. So there's a lot that goes into it. And then you've got somebody's got a cold, you know, this guy's got this, you know, lost a little weight. And, you know, it's, boy, I tell you what, it's a lot of moving parts. So we're always working together. I think that's one of the best parts about strength and conditioning coach. It's just constant communication. You know, not having a set mindset on, okay, this is what we have to be like this week. These guys have got to get stronger. You know, sometimes things change and, you know, the team needs a little bit of a different approach, and our guy's been just terrific with that.
And, Coach, I know you like I said, you mentioned earlier in the interview about you winning the games once in the non-con, you just weren't playing very well. But what points do you feel like your team really improved on the most during the non-con as you entered the full-fledged Ivy League play here coming up here real soon?
Well, we had a rough schedule early on, and I think the schedule was, you know, that's no, you know, my fault, of course, like putting a rough schedule up front. But we had a couple injuries up early on to some key people. But I think that we just the biggest improvement we've made is on the defensive end. And, you know, when you take better shots, usually it allows your defense to set itself up better. We've done a much better job of that and allowing our defense to be 5-on-5. And then here in our first two conference games, we've seen the team really focus and lock in defensively on, you know, the things you need to do to win. And I think this is the most important part of being successful in any league is being able to guard man-to-man. And you know, if you follow basketball, it's being able to defend. Yeah, that keeps you in every game.
You got that right. I always tell young men, I speak to them, energy, effort, and defense, you have a chance every night. Those three things, you have a chance every night. Energy, effort, and defense. If you just do those three things, because it's boiled down to make or miss scoring-wise, but you can always do those three things, you have a chance for sure.
Yeah, and, you know, we made 11 threes in our last game against Penn, but in the first game we only made two. And sometimes that's going to happen, and you're going to need your defense to kick in.
And I also feel like, Coach, for you playing those tough quality mid-majors and high majors, that helps strengthen your teams, get hard in their shells a little, give them some callus when they get ready to play, like, say, the Ivy League schools who know you guys, where they really have to execute well. So you've seen different styles. You know what you're going to get in the Ivy League for the most part. But I think having that adversity early will help them later down the road, especially when it comes down to time late in the year for that Ivy League tournament coming up there as well.
I agree. You know, the sooner you can figure out what you're going to need when the game's on the line in your non-conference schedule, the better it helps you later in the year. And it's really it's a trial. The non-conference season gets you ready for these moments that you don't exactly know are going to, you know, how it's all going to unfold. But hopefully, and I think our group is true, this is true of our group, that these moments allow you to be best prepared to see anything. And the most important thing is that you're absolutely unafraid of the moment. That's the most important thing. You just, okay, here's where we are, let's go. And you don't fear losing or I haven't seen this before. You know, we played Hofstra, who beat us at our place. They're a very good team. They played a matchup zone, and it did bother us. And we saw a matchup the next two games, and it didn't bother us as much. So you learn, as long as you keep learning and you're not afraid, you're going to have success.
That's what I got for you, Coach, is this. Who has been some coaches and individuals in your career that really meant the most to you as you went on your coaching journey so far?
Well, I've been really fortunate to have been around great coaches as a player. So Coach Pete Carew, when I was an undergrad, you know, the guy that I played for in college, his name is Bill Carmody. You know, I actually worked for him for a while as an assistant coach. So, you know, I think that, and then, you know, the ability to be able to bounce things off other coaches as you're going through, you know, your coaching career, you know, in particular, I've become close with some of the guys that were on the Wisconsin staff. I was in the Big Ten for a little while. But I think really, like, who you surround yourself with on your own staff, that's key too. The staff is terrific. They work really hard to prepare our guys to be their best.
Coach Henderson, thanks for coming on the show today. I hope to see you at the Final Four. If you come down to the Final Four, see you at the Final Four for sure. And our best luck to you as well in Ivy League season going forward, Coach.
I really appreciate your time, and thanks for having me on.
Anytime, Coach. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, take care.
It's Mitch Henderson on the Bossman Show.
How do you feel about your office? Is it just a space for your company, or is it a space to help you grow your company? From new HQs to satellite offices, with WeWork, you can find a space that works for you. Visit we.co/spacematters to learn more.
Folks, back in the Bossman Show, Derek Kellogg of the LIU Sharks, now with us at the Northeast Conference. Coach, what's up in the city, man?
Everything is fantastic. We've had some great weather. As you know, there's always something to do in the city, and you know, my team's playing pretty well. So it's been a good holiday season. You know, we're excited to continue here at conference play, and you know, me and my family just love living in the New York City area. It's been a great change of pace for us, and I'm excited to be on the show and spend some time with you.
Well, Coach, tell me this. I know we haven't talked since 2018, so talk to us about the developments in your program. How's it improved since me and you last talked in March of 18 when we went to the tournament back then?
Yeah, it was great. You know, we've done a good job, I think, of you know, putting a hell of a product on the floor. I think our guys are competing at a great level. You know, the 2018 NCAA tournament run, I think, you know, solidified our, you know, the LIU program is one that to be reckoned with in our conference. And, you know, the recruiting has definitely picked up, you know, since that point. And, you know, we're having a nice year this year. I thought last year we made a good run in the in the tournament, or the NEC tournament. And, you know, in the one bid leagues, which obviously the NEC is, you know, we really gear ourselves towards playing well throughout the season, but most importantly, trying to play well for those 3 days of March so you can get that run at the NCAA tournament. And so I think we're in a good place right now. My team's competing, playing really hard, and we got a good bunch of kids that are getting better as things go on.
And, Coach, a big part is that player development piece in the offseason when you got those kids with you there in the summertime and early fall before November tips off, get those guys better and individually and collectively as a group, see watching film and on-court drills and getting stronger with the strength coach as well, Coach.
Yeah, you know, and I think that's one thing, you know, I've prided myself on as an assistant coach back at Memphis with Calipari and then through my head coaching days at UMass and now here at LIU is I think people that watch our teams can say that the players individually – and as a unit have gotten better, the guys look like they've gotten bigger and stronger throughout their careers. And, you know, a testament to that is how many guys went from unknowns or not recruited to playing professionally, whether a few of them have snuck into the NBA. But, you know, quite a few of my guys from my UMass days and even my LIU days here are playing professionally overseas, whether it's Caddy Lalane, Maxi Esho, Raphael Putney. Those guys are doing fantastic. And then Chaz Williams and then even some of the guys that are had just graduated from here at LIU. So they're able to make a living, you know, playing professionally or getting into coaching. And if they don't do that, most of the guys are, you know, doing pretty well in what I call the real world, whether, you know, they're on, say, Wall Street or teaching or doing things in the community. You know, I'm most proud that we've had a great graduation rate. All my guys have pretty much graduated, that they're doing good, positive things in the community. And I think the more guys that we can put out there that can be role models for kids, hopefully that's, you know, going to continue to the trend of having more positive influences for the young people.
Most definitely, Coach, because these young men, when they're with you, their job is to go to school and play basketball and grow into men. And hearing that you're graduating most of your guys, APR's real high there, getting guys in the community, becoming community men, that's a great statement for you and your staff, Coach. It's great. I love to hear so.
Yeah, well, I appreciate that. You know, our APR is 1,002 years running, and hopefully that'll continue. You know, if you're on the line to graduate, you will. And more often than not, I've been able to graduate. When I say I, we put the kids in a position where they can graduate in 3 years. And, you know, with summer school and sometimes winter session and some online classes that they can take at different occasions, I think the kids now day and age should shoot for graduating early and play that last year with grad school under their belt. To me, that's a great opportunity for a free education. And then while you're doing that, I believe that the kids should learn about community service and getting into the environment and getting into their, you know, community to spend some time to, you know, to give themselves good work experience for when they actually enter the real world when they, you know, when they get out of college.
And, Coach, for the young men here in Atlanta, I feel like they can go to your school, LIU Brooklyn, up there with LIU now, and still get a great city experience, get to play for a great coach like yourself, and get a great degree behind them, and learn about life in a big city like Atlanta, you know, and play basketball, live their dream, hopefully play professionally. If not, like we said, be on Wall Street, be a businessman, entrepreneur, or a teacher, or a husband.
Yeah, and I agree with you fully. I think there's definitely some similarities. You know, we're one of the few schools remaining that are actually a downtown school. We're in downtown Brooklyn, and in the last, I don't know, give it 5 or 6 years, there's been more, you know, 60 to 70 story high rises going up with condos and restaurants and things within walking distance of the campus. So what's really happened here is downtown Brooklyn is now really an extension of downtown Manhattan. You know, it's one train stop from Wall Street. It's one train stop from the Statue of Liberty and, you know, the Freedom Tower. And then you can get to Times Square and three stops on the Q train. So it really is an unbelievable experience in a city where, you know, the saying, if you can make it in New York, you can make it anywhere. Now that I've lived here, I understand kind of what that means. And there's so much opportunity and so much things that you can be successful at. You know, it's a good selling point for kids that want to really try to make it.
Now, Coach, the non-conference schedule, you know, you're always on the road a lot, of course, because you play guaranteed games, play away a lot. So talk to us about what your team will really improve doing, having faced adversity, being on the road a lot, doing the non-con, and seeing different styles of play as you get ready for this NEC grind you're on right now.
Well, you know, it's funny you mention that because while you're going through it, sometimes the biggest thing is to keep your kids together, realize that, you know, it can be a daunting task to be on the road for 12, 13 days when we went to played at San Diego State, played at Texas Tech, and then played a couple games out in Las Vegas. So those can be challenging. And I think the biggest thing is to making sure that you have good kids that realize that this is a great challenge for you. I mean, we played, and I don't think people realize, you know, San Diego State, we're down 5 at the half, lost by 15. We're up 1 at Texas Tech at the half. You know, I think we scored more points in the half than any team since Kansas 2 years ago against Texas Tech. So there's some positives that you need to pull out of some of those games that doesn't always end up on the scoreboard of wins and losses. So, it was a good challenge for our guys. I thought we were somewhat battle-tested now coming into league, and what you realize is it prepares you to try to win on the road, which is obviously so difficult in college basketball. And I thought our guys handled the adversity in the test pretty well.
Exactly, because I can only imagine being in conference, having to deal with that. It's like, hey, we can go on the road and play Frederick Dickinson or Merrimack or whoever it may be in the conference and win there, because we've played San Diego State, we've played these Texas Techs, so and they're the higher level than in our conference. We're not scared of these guys because we know how good those teams were. We was right there with those guys, so they should feel very confident playing anybody in the NEC right now.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the toughest thing for a coach is just managing the average fan or family or people that don't understand kind of the bye game philosophy or having to go on the road. So when you're sitting there at, say, 5-8 going into conference, the average fan's calling, checking in on you, asking you how you're doing, what happened at Texas Tech or San Diego State. And I think the reality of it is, your record sometimes might not be indicative of how good your team is. And I think that's something that, you know, you can only measure yourself as a coach being through it for a long time.
Exactly. And you know what? Also, I know as coaches that, hey, you've been defending your home court pretty well as well. So I know you probably emphasize with the guys, we got to win our home games for sure and definitely try to split these on the road at least.
Yeah, you know, I think when you enter conference play, your main goal is to guard home court advantage, to try to win as many at home as you can. And then, honestly, we call it almost like taking some on the road, seeing how many you can steal as road games. And, you know, right now we've done a decent job of that thus far in the conference of winning a couple road games. We've played pretty well at home. And so I'm hoping that trend can continue throughout the conference play.
And can I talk about that, Coach? You got to a good start in conference play. You're 4-2 right now in conference play. So talk to us about what's been the keys to your start in conference play being 4-2 so far.
Well, I think we've ramped up our defensive intensity some. You know, I tell our guys all the time, if you guys will ramp up the defense and rebound the basketball, we're a really good offensive team when those things happen. So we've played some better team defense. We've rebounded with all five guys. And the games that we actually haven't played so well throughout the year, we've gotten beat pretty good on the boards. And so that's been kind of a focal point for our team. Unfortunately, you know, we haven't had a ton of practice time because of how many games we've played back-to-back-to-back. And because we're not playing a ton of guys, I think making sure that they're fresh and kind of feel good is as important as, beating them up at practice, as some people may say.
I was going to ask you about that, Coach, because I know you're not playing that many guys, and you have a Thursday, Saturday pretty much on pretty much a day between. So how do you manage that, knowing you're playing a limited amount of guys, knowing you got 2 games in 3 days pretty much there?
Yeah, well, you have to trust your team. I mean, that they're going to mentally prepare for these games. I mean, when you play a Thursday night, 7 o'clock game, and then come back Saturday at 12, 1, 2, or 4, there's not really much you can do on a Friday. I think it's as much mental as it is physical, that they understand game plan, that they can understand how we're trying to win the basketball game, and then you're really relying on your team to go execute. In a weird way, you're kind of telling them, here's the game plan, we're going to go through it, and then it's up to you guys to go win and execute.
Got that right. You know, and I feel like that's where the film room comes in handy, because I feel like the best way to teach a young man, besides being on the court, is in that film room, because the eye in the sky doesn't lie, Coach. You and I both know that. So you can point out on film where you should have been in this spot right here on the closeout, on a rotation, you missed that, or you didn't screen or all the way how you should have, or should have flared the right way. So I feel like using that film is a way to get a guy to understand, especially when you have short rest and don't have time to actually get on the court and prepare via a walkthrough or practice.
Yeah, I agree with you fully. And a lot of times players, what they see in their mind and what's actually seen on the film are way on the opposite end.
Night and day.
So, they're on their phones. They watch video. Like, this is not something that they're not accustomed to And I think film is a great way for them to see themselves, which everybody loves to do. They love to see themselves. But they also need to be able to see themselves doing the right stuff and the wrong stuff so that we can improve and get better.
Yes, and Coach, well, I hope you keep on going where you're going. I hope to see you the Final Four in Atlanta here because we're just down here this year. Coach, hope to see you down here, man, in April, man.
All right, well, let's definitely catch up. We'll definitely be down there, and I'll be looking for you guys.
All right, Coach, thank you so much. Have a good one, man. Talk to you real soon, buddy.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
It's maybe the night that my dreams might let me know. All the stars are closer. All the stars are closer.
Tell me what you're going to do to me. Confrontation ain't nothing new to me. You could bring a bullet, bring a sword, bring a morgue, but you can't bring the truth to me.
Alexa, play Kendrick Lamar and SZA.
Okay.
With Amazon Music, a voice is all you need. Get tens of millions of songs. Download the Amazon Music app today.
Folks, back on the Boss Man Show here, Joe Gallo, the Merrimack Warriors here out of Massachusetts up there in Northeast. Coach, how are things up there in Massachusetts, Coach?
Things are great. We just got back from a five-day road trip out to Western Pennsylvania. Had two really good wins. Going into the weekend, Robert Morris was undefeated in the league at 4-0, and we were 4-1, and St. Francis Pennsylvania was 4-1 as well, and we were able to go out there and pick up two wins. So we hopped back on a flight this morning, and we're back in the Boston area in first place in the NEC, so it feels pretty good.
Yes, indeed. Well, Coach, you're in the middle of year four leading the Warriors. What have been your greatest accomplishment in your mind so far since you've been hired there in 2016 there?
You know what? I would say even with the Division I transition, last year winning – the league we were in Division II is one of the best Division II leagues in the country, and we won the conference tournament title last year for the first time since 2000 at our school. So anytime you do something that hasn't been done in 19 years, I think is a huge accomplishment. And then obviously, in our second game ever in Division I to go at Northwestern and win on the road at a Big Ten school was another milestone as well. So. I would say one of those two, pick which one, but, one was took a little more. It was a whole season thing and winning an actual title and then going in that one game and that one moment was huge for our program at Northwestern as well.
And Coach, talk about the D1 transition. I know it's a little bit different for us. You can't probably play postseason, different things with scholarships.
Yep.
So can you just kind of explain for our listeners and the audience what are the things you guys kind of having to endure as you transition from D2 now to D1 in the NEC?
Yeah, so right off the bat, so in Division II, you're only allowed the 10 full scholarships. In Division I, you get 13. So we got the full allotment right away. Another big advantage that we were able to do is in Division II, you're not allowed to work with your players in the summertime, but in Division I, you can do the 8 weeks of summer and have them up there lifting and working out. So our administration was great. Those two things were two very important things to me, and they gave us the full scholarships. We were able to bring in a really good freshman class, and we had our guys up, all summer that implementing our system and getting our old guys and our new guys on the same page. So. Those were two early things that were added to us right away. The next steps are, some more staffing. Most Division I programs, just about all really, have, three full-time assistant coach and director of basketball ops. And, some even go further with video and other positions. So right now it's really only myself and two other assistant coaches right now. So we're kind of just a three-man army here trying to take on the world.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, Coach, but for me, you already have this great amount of wins here, 12 wins and 6 wins in non-con, and you're a transitional school. So what tells me you had a great thing going already, in your transition, for sure.
Yeah, we were, and we won a lot of close games. We have three seniors that, they started just about every game since they stepped foot on campus. And, we played in three straight Division II NCAA tournaments. And those guys have just won a lot of games. So sometimes, even early in the year, people asked about that Northwestern game. Of course, they were bigger and faster and stronger at most positions, but they were playing a lot of young guys, that have never even played in college basketball game before. So, when you have
three seniors who have won, you know, 65, 66 games in their first 3 years, no matter what the level. You know, you get to that under four minute media and it's a 2-3 point game either way. You have, you know, one team that has a group of guys who's been through it, and a lot of time on some of these other rosters, there's some guys that haven't been in those moments before. So, you know, our guys have, you know, it took a few games to adjust to the new speed of the game, but from the mental side and being in close games and winning close games, you know, I have a bunch of guys that have been through the ringer already, so that's really translated.
And, Coach, I think it's really, really important going forward is the strength and conditioning program, because playing against the D1 competition with bigger, stronger guys, faster guys, you need to be stronger in optimal shape and speed there. So having a great strength coach gets the guys to eat right, sleep right, and also prevent injuries by being stronger and being physically fit and in their core intact will be very important for you guys going forward as player development it takes even over even more.
Yeah, and that's going to be huge, because we you know, we think as a staff we have a pretty good eye for the basketball side of things, and, you know, and in these early years we're going to have to get creative, so we may have to take a kid who's, you know, a little bit on the skinny side, or maybe you know, we have a freshman right now who, you know, he actually broke his hurt his foot early in September, kind of set him back a little bit. He's been playing great now, but you know, he came in, you know, he was a thicker kid, probably, you know, maybe 15 pounds a little on the heavier side, but you know, the basketball was never an issue. So we're going to try and get creative in our recruiting, and that's when that strength conditioning side of things, to either bulk a guy up or slim a guy down, or, you know, get guys eating right and sleeping right. You know, we'll take care of the basketball side, but, you know, and recruit that right skill level. But we are going to need, you know, guys in the weight room and doing all that stuff to get them on par physically.
Speaking of the recruiting piece, I know you're pretty much in the Boston area there. Great place to be for a young man, a vibrant city. So on the recruiting trail now, being D1, what type of guys are you able to go after now to come to your program that you couldn't in D2 now? And I'm now, with the success you've had so far, I'm pretty sure the phones have been answered a little bit more now.
Yeah, you know what? It just makes that first conversation a lot easier. You know, we were able to, you know, anytime you win a league, you probably have a few players that can play in a league above you, right? So if you're winning the NEC, you probably have some guys that can play in maybe the CAA or the Atlantic 10. And that's how it was for us as a Division II. You know, if you win that Northeast 10 Conference, you're going to have a handful of players on your roster that are probably Division I guys. We just had to wait around a little bit longer in the past and, you know, sift through guys waiting out the Division I offers and seeing what they can get and having to stay on top of them. And it's a little bit easier now. You know, we had three scholarships in this class, and we already filled all three of them in the early signing period. So just that Division I announcement and being Division I, you know, really it makes that first phone call, you know, oh, yeah, I know you guys. You know, they see you on the ticker, and it's just a little bit more known now than just, you know, being – even when you talk to people all the time about the success you had as Division II, it's just a little more of an unknown entity, and it never got people as excited as it does now.
Yes, indeed. And also, I kind of mentioned a little bit, but getting 6 wins in the non-conference schedule, when you got to play guaranteed games, be on the road a lot there, and your team facing adversity, has to make you really happy knowing that your guys pull through, knowing they're at a different level of competition and how they competed that well for you in year one of this transition against better competition for sure.
Yeah, it's been great, and I think that's really helped, especially, you know, in a weekend that just passed, because we, you know, before Christmas, you know, we had a non-Division I home game, but we only played Army before Christmas. We had one true home game before Christmas, so we spent a lot of time on the road. I think our SID informed me last night that William and Mary has 8 road wins, and then, you know, Merrimack and Hofstra have 7 road wins, and those are the three teams with the most true road wins in the country. So to be in our first year and to be in company like that, having the second most true road wins at this point in the season is, you know, makes me very proud.
Now, on the court, Coach, do you feel like your team got better the most during non-conference? I know when you play non-conference, you know, you're kind of trying to find your way, find different rotations, see different styles of play. So we feel like your team really improved on really, really well during non-conference late there before you got into the NEC conference for real.
Well, you know what? We play a we have a system on both sides of the ball. We play an extended 2-3 zone. That's been unbelievable for us. We actually lead the country in turnover rate. We're turning our opponents over, you know, about 25% of their possessions. And then we have a, you know, on offense we play, you know, similar to how Michigan used to play under John Beilein with some of that two-guard front stuff. So our guys really know what we are and who we are. And we just really work on our system every day. And the other thing that's helped is we're actually redshirting a couple guys. So, you know, out of our 13 scholarships, we redshirted two freshmen. And then we have a sophomore who had an injury, and he decided to redshirt as well. So those 10 guys, at least nine of them, they know they're playing and they know they're in the rotation. And that's really helped with chemistry. I actually just read an article. You know, Eric Musselman done that at Nevada, and he's doing that at Arkansas now. He said he used to hate, you know, he'd be an assistant and he'd go into a locker room that's trying to play 13 guys and two guys ain't happy on a given night or another guy doesn't know if he's going to play. You know, with us redshirting these guys, we've really allowed these 9-10 guys to just come out every day and get better and play with confidence because they know the rotation is what it is. And I think that's very helped. You know, it's really helped these guys get some game experience under their belt. You know, practice is one thing, but, you know, the best way to get better is to get thrown in the fire and see what you got against other people.
And putting out to in guys, Coach, you keep guys very fresh and happy. You keep guys engaged as well. When you have at least those guys alive, then one day again in the game, they get some run there. And also, come tournament time in March, we got to play back-to-back-to-back. Having that depth to be able to play 9-10 guys on that third day or whatever you have to do to win it, to get that bid, it's going to be very important when you have guys who have been alive all year long and playing and in shape there.
Yeah, it's been great, and we actually had we've had 8 different guys lead us in scoring this year on different nights. So it's kind of pick your poison at different times. You know, our defense has kind of been a constant, but it's been really a different guy every night. We had Idris Joyner, who's our starting 5-man, really at only 6'4". He had 28 on the road at St. Francis, PA, and 11 from 12 from the field, and you know that just kind of. I don't want to say it came out of nowhere, but it was a career high, and he picked a pretty good time to do it on the road against the other first-place team. So, I think it makes us a little hard to guard. We don't have Javaris Hayes has the ball a ton, and he's been our leader for 4 years now, but it could really be anybody on any given night that could, you know, step up and make that big shot down the stretch.
And Coach, y'all tough a game against Fred Dickinson this weekend here. You know, Greg Herner does a great job. He's very energetic, of course. We know he's very energetic.
Yeah.
And they got won a game last year in the tournament there. So tough test against those guys. We're some families get ready for Coach Herner's team there.
You know what? We have a ton of respect for G. He's a Merrimack alum, and he's very proud of it. He supports our program. When I first got the job and we were at Division II, he had us down and played them in an exhibition game 4 years ago when my seniors were freshmen. So it's, you know, his teams are going to play hard. They're going to play with a ton of energy. You know, they're just coming off a big win. I think, you know, they struggled a little bit in the non-conference, but he's not scared to go out and play everybody. So it's really hard to gauge who they truly are until conference play comes because, you know, they went at Notre Dame, they went at Kentucky, and you know, that's kind of been his thing the last couple of years, is going out and playing the big boys. So, you know, we're looking forward to the challenge, and our guys are up for it. There's, Caleb Bishop, their starting 5-man, played at St. Anthony High School in Jersey City, and my 3 seniors all played with him at for Coach Early at St. Anthony in Jersey City. So there's a lot of, knowns between the two programs, and we're just looking forward to go out and compete.
That's what I got for you, Coach, is this. What were some coaches and some individuals in the business of coaching really helped you in your career and the guys you kind of lean on when things get tough for you?
Yep, that's right. And Greg's been like a mentor, and he's always a phone call away, and he's been texting me every year since I got the job. Anytime we have a big win, he always reaches out. So it's kind of all love when it's going to be Merrimack versus FDU between Coach Arenda and myself.
I'll definitely be neutral. I like both of you guys already because I've been able to show too. So I'll be very neutral. I like both of you. So either way, I hope everybody leaves healthy. That's what I'm hoping. Everybody leaves with their health because I know it's going to be a good battle between you and Coach Rinder for sure.
Has he told you about his radio show?
Yeah, he told me he'll have me on his radio show real soon. He told me that. It'll be out in Jersey and New York. He told me all about it, the Greg Herner Show. He told me all about it offline for sure.
The Herner Show. He's had me on twice. He hasn't had me on in a couple of years now, but I got to get back on that thing.
Me and you both. We got to get it. me and you both. And Coach Gallo, have a great week. Hope to talk to you real soon. If you're coming to Final Four Atlanta, I hope to see you down here as well, Coach.
JR, I appreciate you having me.
Anytime. Thank you so much.
Have a great night. Till the tears run down from my eyes, Lord, somebody, ooh, somebody, can anybody find me somebody to
love? Alexa, play hits from Queen.
Okay.
With Amazon Music, a voice is all you need. Get tens of millions of songs. Download the Amazon Music app today.
Folks, back on the Bossman Show. For the first time, we're joined by Joe Jones, coach of the Boston University Terriers. Coach Jones, what's up with you in Boston, man?
How you doing, man? I'm trying to stay warm out here in the Northeast, man.
Things I hear you. Good, though. I hear you, Coach. We're coming up your way on February 1st with the Hawks, man. So hopefully it'll be a little warmer when we come up there in about 10 days.
You got it, my man. You got it. I'll be thinking of you. I'll be thinking of you.
Yes, indeed. Well, Coach, I'm telling you, I wanted to bring in the show because, you know, you've been at Boston University for going into the middle of your ninth season, Coach. What's the key to your longevity in a business where so much turnover and the carousel every March and April always is turning? But how have you been able to make sure you've been at Boston University for the last 9 years?
Yeah, that's a good question, my man. First, I think, you know, I have to give a lot of credit to our administration, our athletic director, Drew Marichello, and our president, President Bob Brown. I think that's where it starts, you know, administration, you know, having patience, also understanding, you know, what we stand for, what I stand for as a man and as a coach, and just trying to do the right things by my kids. And quite simply, my philosophy is I want to give my guys the best overall experience I can give them, you know, whether it's on the court, in the classroom, outside the classroom. You know, we want to give them the best all around experience we can give them. So, you know, our guys are doing internships in the summertime, you know, we're working them out like everybody else and trying to get them better. You know, we're making sure they're getting their degrees and making sure they're having opportunities outside the classroom to learn more about themselves and more about the world. And so that's what we're all about, you know, and hopefully the people here, you know, understand that and respect that. And hopefully that has a something to do with my longevity outside of the fact that, you know, we're winning enough games and keeping people happy.
Yeah, for sure, because I feel like, you know, in this business, they don't give you guys enough time to actually grow a program. It's they want you to do it in 1 or 2 years. If you don't do it in 1 or 2 years, they want to get rid of you and start over the next process. I feel like you got to give a guy a chance to actually build a program, and you need to have the AD and to have the president and administration aligned with the coach so you can get that done and not be like a quick hooker. As you see a lot of different places around the country where it's a quick hooker on guys, and they never get back in the business. It'd be assistance the rest of their careers.
No question. And now that there's so many challenges now, you know, with trying to be successful, you know, with kids, you know, with kids transferring, the transfer rule, and how easy it is to kind of put your name in the portal, and how you can lose guys. And, you know, it only takes losing one or two key guys that can throw you off, you know, and then you got injuries and all that, all the other stuff that you have. So it's not easy to be good consistently. I think that takes a little bit of luck and hard work in order to do it. And that's why I applaud guys like Jay Wright, who is my mentor and a great friend of mine, and what he's been able to do with his career for so long. It's hard to do that. My brother is the head coach at Yale, and he's, you know, he's never come in less than fourth place in 20 plus years. And so, you know, when you have that, you know, and you have guys like that around you, it helps me kind of understand what I got to do to be a better coach.
Yeah, I had your brother on early in the year. I think I had him on like in October, November. I had your brother on the show. We were talking to him about his program at Yale. So, yeah, no doubt, man, your brother's a good dude as well.
And, yeah, he's a good guy.
Now, for you, Coach, I know it perpetually you got to really kind of get guys who develop a little bit later. You got to find a guy or project the guy. So, the professional development for you guys is very, very important at Boston University. So, talk about your professional development program, how you go about trying to develop young men on and off the court, and also get them strong with your strength coach in the eat right, and sleep well.
No doubt. It is all those things. And it's one of those things where, you know, it takes a village, right? So, you need to have the right strength coach. You know, you need to have the right nutritionist, and you need to have people around that can, you know, educate these guys on the proper amount of sleep and what they need to be eating. A lot of times when guys come in, you know, they don't really understand that. So you have to kind of start to break those habits and have them understand what they need to put in their bodies and how much that could impact them. And obviously, the you know, being in the weight room and understanding how, you know, to kind of build your body and educating them on that. So there's, you know, you need a lot of people around in terms of that and developing these guys. And then obviously you have to have a staff that can help you develop these guys on the court and off the court. So some of the things that we try to do, as I alluded to earlier, you know, we have our guys, especially our upperclassmen, involved in internships. So we've had guys work for, you know, for lawyers and business people and architects and marketing people over the years. It's been unbelievable for them to get an experience outside the classroom. We've had 9 guys in the last 4 years get their master's degree while they were undergrads. You know, they were able to graduate in 3 years because they're here for summer school and they're taking a full course load. And so we're really proud of those things, you know, those things within our program in terms of how we try to give our guys the best experience we can provide. This past summer, we went to Spain for 10 days, had an unbelievable trip there, went sightseeing to all the great cities, Barcelona, Madrid, and so have you. So that was awesome. And then, you know, we were in Mexico for 4 days around the Thanksgiving break, and that was awesome, you know, to play in that tournament there. So, you know, we feel good about what we're trying to provide our guys, and then we're just trying to pick the right types of people here. You know, we're trying to get guys that really match it with the values of what we are all about at BU, and that's being a person of high character and someone that really wants to be educated and taking it and wants to take advantage of what it's all about and wants to be someone that's a leader in the community. So those are things that we kind of look for and try to stress. And right now, this is probably the best group we've had from top to bottom in terms of who we are and what we want to be. And I think they represent our university the right way.
Yes, indeed, Coach. Is that what you want to have in a program, as you laid out there so eloquently right there, Coach? Great job on that. Yep. And also, Coach, you got 6 wins in 9 con. Has to make you happy. Knowing you got to be on the road a lot, playing different tournaments, not many home games, got to play some bye games here and there as well.
No doubt.
Knowing all that that's going on, to get 6 wins, has to make you really happy knowing all that that's in front of you there.
No question, man. It's, you know, it's not easy, and people that coach at this level know, you know, it's really hard to get home games, right? So you're trying your best to get home games. It's hard to do. You know, there's some years we've only had 4, you know, we've gone through a couple of years, we've had 3 and 4 home games. So that's been tough. So when you're able to go on the road and beat a team like South Carolina in their gym, you know, that was probably the highlight of the non-conference schedule. You know, those are great achievements. And I told the team after the game, I really feel like there are great things headed towards because we really have the right guys and we have guys that really play for each other and want to represent the university and play for each other and play for the players that have been here in this program in the past. It's been such a great program for so long, way before I got here. So, you know, this is really a dream come true for me to be able to be the leader of this basketball program.
Now, on the court, Coach, what do you feel like your team really got improved on the court? Because you saw different styles of play, different types of players, different type of teams. So what do you feel like getting exposed to all different types of styles of play really helps your team on the court as you see them play in the Patriot League now?
Well, I think the one thing that we do, I think our guys do a great job of playing team basketball. I think we play – defensively, we play as a group, we play as a unit, and then offensively, we do the same thing. We do a great job of sharing the ball and playing together, and our guys are really into it, you know, and we don't have to talk to our guys about shot selection a lot or about, you know, sometimes we overhelp because we're trying to help each other so much. And, you know, this is, you know, for me, this has been awesome. But those are the things. If you come watch us play, I think you will see a team that's committed to playing hard and committed to playing, you know, the right way, and that's playing together and making each other better, you know. I think we do a good job of that.
And having that synergy, Coach, is so important for a team. When the guys are playing for each other, and that synergy, the ball moves, gives you energy, you bring the effort every night. And I feel
no doubt.
You win or lose, you feel like you have a chance every night. When you have that synergy, I feel like your team has already.
No doubt. That's kind of what we've been doing. And, you know, we kind of went through a run here. You know how it is. You know, we're still growing. I thought, you know, in the non-conference, we had a lot of guys coming back, but we still have only one senior this year. So we're really still a young team. And you know, we lost a lot of close games, and we were right there in the end. And I knew we were going to play better as the year went on, and then things started to click. And you know how it is. It's a long season, and, you know, you're going to have your ups and downs. But I really feel like you do, like, you know, we're putting ourselves in a position to have success most nights because we're playing hard and we're playing together.
And, Coach, 6-1 at home. So defending the home court has to be very emphasis you give your guys, especially when conference play starts, because you want to get the home games for sure, try to split on the road there.
No doubt. You got to get those home wins, man. We got a big one tomorrow night against a very good Navy team, and we got to try to get it done because it's hard to be successful if you can't win in your home floor.
Yeah, like you said, Coach, look at our Navy team. What are you sending from the guys on film, Coach? I know you got Holy Cross as well this week as well. So you got two tough games back-to-back here. So first for Navy, so what are you sending those guys on film, Coach?
Well, the first thing I'll tell you that jumps out at you, man, as always, they are committed to playing hard. You know, so to beat them, you really got to be ready to bring it and commit to, you know, competing. And I think the thing that they do the best is they go after the ball. You know, loose balls, 50-50 balls, rebounds, they're all over it. They're sending 3, 4, and 5 to the glass really consistently. And those guys are just, you know, they're just coming, you know, and they do it with a great sense of urgency. So, you know, we have to be ready to commit to that. And then their perimeter is really good. They got 3 really good perimeter guys that can all beat you in different ways. And then they have depth up front where they can kind of pound the ball at the rim. So they're a really solid team from top to bottom. You know, we have our hands full, but it's a great test. It's a great test coming off the loss we had against Colgate without our best player being able to play the majority of the time. And now coming back and playing this really good team, you know, we're looking forward to the challenge.
And, Coach, prep-wise, when you have to play these games back-to-back kind of with the day between, so how you go about preparing during the week before you have to deal with this this quick turnaround when you got Holy Cross after playing Navy there?
Yeah, my thing is I take one at a time. I really don't. It's so funny. I ran into the Navy coach on Monday at an event. And, they're literally 40 miles away from us in Worcester. And, we were at an event in Springfield, and I ran into him, and we chopped it up, and then I said, I'll see you soon, and he goes, I'll see you Saturday. I didn't even know we played him Saturday.
Wow.
You know, I was just locked in on Wednesday, you know, and honestly, I'm kind of one game at a time type guy. I couldn't even tell you next week. I think we play Loyola next week, but I'm not even positive about that. So I'm really been able to in my career kind of focus on, you know, just what's ahead of me. And right now the next game, and I hope that my team looks at it that way and that we can kind of go out and play consistent basketball because we're not caught up in the magnitude of this game over that game. We kind of went into the game against Colgate and said, hey, you know, everybody wants to talk about this is for first place and the whole bid. And if that helps to motivate you, that's fine, but that's really not what it's all about. And so it's really having a growth mentality and trying to get better every day and trying to beat a good Colgate team because they are the people that are in your way today, you know, and tomorrow it's going to be Navy. They're in our way, you know, and if we look at it that way, then we won't get too high or too low, and then we got a chance to get better. And that's what this is all about, you know, who's going to be at their best when you must have your best late in March, early March. And that's kind of what I'm trying to get our guys to do. And along the way, you want to win as many games as you can, and having home court as much as you can for the playoffs is crucial. So you're trying to put yourself in that situation, but really trying to get better is where you got to stay focused on.
That's what I got for you, Coach. Who have been some coaches individually in your career really had a big impact on you professionally and personally as your journey of coaching?
Yeah. I'll tell you the first one is my high school coach. You know, my high school coach was, you know, my junior year was a great guy. You know, he was a great mentor, Warren Isaacs. He was a great player at Iona. He was the Hagerty Award winner at Iona. That means you're the best player in New York State that year in his senior year. And then he went on and had a great career at Iona. And then my senior year had a guy by the name of Al Kendelman, who I'm still close with today. I got married 20 years ago, I will say 19 years ago, and he was at my wedding and really close and gave me a lot of confidence in myself. And I never forgot that as I coach now, trying to give guys confidence. He was one of the first coaches that really gave me a lot of confidence. and helped me really succeed. You know, I went from a guy that averaged 2 points a game as a junior to averaging 19 as a senior. And he had a lot to do with outside of my hard work I put into the game. I thought he had a lot to do with it, reassuring me that I could be successful. So, and then college, I had a guy that, you know, to this day is, you know, he was at my wedding as well and spent a lot of time with his family. I consider him a second father and his wife, a second mom, Paul Callahan from Mexico. And then when I got into coaching, I was fortunate enough to worked for a guy by the name of Frank Romeo, who was a great coach in Long Island. And I had played against him when I was coming through. And then I got my first job at the school that he worked at. And I was able to be his middle school coach and sit on his bench for the varsity games. And, you know, and I just learned so much from him and just his organization and his ability to get his players to play hard and play the right way. And he was just all about, he was a high character guy. He was all about the right things. And then he was the one that introduced me to the Villanova staff with Rolly Massimino and a young Jay Wright, who was the basketball ops guy at that time. We went to their camp and met Jay. And then the rest is history. Jay hired me on his first staff at Hofstra. And I learned so much from him and a guy by the name of Tom Bacora, who actually ended up becoming the head coach at Hofstra after Jay was gone and the head coach at Fordham. So, you know, those are two guys that I learned a lot from. But I would say Jay is the one that I've learned the most from in terms of, you know, how to run a program, you know, how to run a program, how to get the most out of your players. You know, he was just sensational. And I had a chance to see him, you know, on the ground floor as he started to put his stamp on the college game and watch him as a young coach have some setbacks and then kind of work through those setbacks and learn how to be successful, you know. And so, you know, just so much from so many people. I tell people that all the time. You know, my job now is to serve others and to give as much as I can to help young coaches, help my players become the type of people that they want to be. And part of that is because that's what I had when I was coming up.
Well, Coach, keep that train going. We need more brothers coaching in the business, guys. We're losing too many of us. We know we lost half of us this past carousel. So we need more brothers to keep the train going for sure. Keep that pipeline coming.
You got it, my man. You got it. I'll do my best.
Hey, Coach, hope to see the Final Four, man. Hope you come down to the ATL, man, the Final Four up to catch you. Hope you come by our studio here and see us in April here real soon.
You got it. Let's keep in touch. I appreciate the call.
Will do, Coach. Thank you so much, man.